Continue reading verse 2.
And we cried mightily with a strong voice, and the prophet of the great is fallen, is fallen. It is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every false spirit, and the gates of every unfaithful bird.
Continue verse 3. Okay, look for the verse. Alas, alas, that great city. What verse? Everyone, browse. Verse 10. Now, everyone read at the same time, verse 10.
Standing after all the fear of God.
Read aloud, chief brother.
Alas, alas, the great city. The city. The
let's all pray. Close our eyes. Make sure, look at your children if their eyes are closed. Or cover their eyes. Let's bow our heads. Lord, we come to Thee today with much weakness and shortcomings. Forgive us, Lord. Cleanse our hearts for our lukewarmness, for our relaxation, for not being zealous over serving Thee in our families. We are not zealous over Thy word. Revive us, Lord. Bring us this hunger and thirst for Thy righteousness through the word of God, through Your revelation. Lord, have mercy on us. Have mercy on this church. Have mercy on each and every family. Convict our hearts that we may seek Thee, O Lord. Praise Thee and bless Thee. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so right now we're talking about two cities. Now what is the other city aside from Babylon?
New Jerusalem.
Aside from Babylon is Jerusalem. Everyone say Jerusalem.
Jerusalem.
So Babylon represents the world. By the way, this is a half sheet of paper. Babylon, everyone say Babylon. Now, that city has become a representation of this world. Some prophetic soothsayers would say that's Iraq. Of course, it's located in Iraq, the original empire of Babylon, the original city of Babylon. Then others would say, when we quote the verse, alas, alas, Babylon is fallen, is when the Twin Towers fell after an airplane strike, terrorist strike. Now, what is real Babylon? Now, United States is an alternate peace. So, it does not follow with this parallel of Babylon. United States could represent Babylon, but not directly. United States has been used by God and used by the devil to pollute the world. And that's what you're enjoying today. You know, it's like good and evil. Out from her came the gospel. Out of her came democracy, but out of her came forth corruption. All manner of corruption. How many of you are watching television? Well, raise your hands. One? Only one? Two? Three? Admit it. Everyone who watches television, raise your hands. higher. Sister Ami, yes, thank you for your honesty. Please stay raised up. Keep it up. Okay. Say amen. Is it worthy television? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. That's Babylon. You don't have to go to malls. You don't have to go to diversions, entertainments. You have it in your living room. You have it in your home. You have it in your cell phone. You have it in your friends. You also have it in schools. You have it in idle time. But we're not going to go into patriarchal training yet. We're going to talk about prophecy. Babylon in Revelation chapter 18 represents the world. It's no longer Iraq. It's not just the Vatican. It's not just the Catholic Church. Not just United States. It represents the world. Could you look for the verse? So let's have some competition. Brother Samuel, Sister Erica, Sister Yana, Brother Allen, you're included. Look for the verse that Babylon praised the souls of men. Of course, that's not the exact word, but you will look for the word souls of men. Please scan Revelation 18. That should be our activities. What verse? Verse 13. Okay, please read, Brother Alan. Babylon.
Verse 13.
18:13.
Please read, Brother Alan.
And cinnamon and odors and ointments, and frankincense and wine and oil and fine flour and wheat and fish and sheep and horses and chariots and slaves and souls of men.
Souls of men. Now, it talks about commodity, merchandise, goods. The free trade. What's happening to the world? It's like a global village for free trade. Yes. Exchange of goods and services. Then, along with it comes the souls of men. How does the souls of men become traded? We are in this sector, the religious sector. Make merchandise over the souls of men. By the way, if you're not a religious group, could you also trade the souls of men? Yes. It's not just bribery or corruption. That the commodity that you trade with, it becomes idolatry, and the souls of men are traded. Listen to me, parents. Are you trading the souls of your children? You do. If you are lukewarm, if you do not care about the message of God, to train your children in the admonition of the Lord, you're training their souls to the world. Aside from the fact, every Nicolaitan church prays the souls of men. When I was with Pastor Villagonza in my previous church, he said it's the Catholic Church. They train the souls of men. Yes, there's the mass, there's the purgatory. You pay some amount and they'll pray for the person to be moved up a bit higher from hellfire. There's indulgence. Well, it's not just the Catholic Church anymore. It's all religions that are Nicolaitan. They crave in the souls of men. And how about those non-religious groups? They also crave in the souls of men. You look at the Bible, look at your Bible, look at those merchandise, spices, goods, everything, perfume. Sometimes it's being traded on the church. Hey, do you want to buy Ava? Listen to me. You're trading for the souls of men if you offer commodity without even helping out in the Word of God. You don't have any compassion for the souls of your fellow neighbor. Then you offer them something else, and their focus goes there. Young people, when you talk to each other, corruption, words.
Come in. I have some exciting thing to tell you.
You're trading their souls for death. It's in your hands to bring them the word. But instead, you want to frolic on other things. It could be in the church. It's not just outside the church. It could be in your households. So that's Babylon. You thought you're out of it. Oh, I'm not part of that. You don't know you have the mark of the beast because you are lukewarm or Nicolaitan. You still follow your flesh. Let's say you're in the forefront of the battle. I'm supposed to witness, but I'm so ashamed to witness. So I'll just keep it to myself. I don't care if they have some problems. You created their souls. Because God has called you to speak the word. So from within our church out to beyond, I at least have an idea how you could be Babylon. Now, what is the other city?
Jerusalem.
Where was it mentioned? Anyone? Jerusalem was mentioned in Revelation chapter 3. Anyone? I'm calling out some names. Sister Yana, Erica, Ala, Yeye, Joseph, Mima, JP, Dave, Sister Amika. What verse is New Jerusalem? Or Heavenly Jerusalem? So you don't have to read. I'm not giving you the verse. You have to tell me what verse.
3:12.
Everyone look at 3:12. I'm not going to read it. I just want all of you to look at it. You we worship God by opening the Bible. Of course, more than that, we share the word. Now, the New Jerusalem is the city counterpart to Babylon. There's Old Jerusalem, there's Old Babylon, but the Old Jerusalem and Old Babylon is no longer the issue here. When you say New Jerusalem, there's a new Babylon. A new Babylon is the world today. And what is the New Jerusalem? All predestined children of God, called out from the world, washed in His blood, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Called to Him, a nation of people to serve Him. Out of every nation, you and I, we could be in that New Jerusalem. That is your hope to come out of Babylon. We're not going to go into literal Jerusalem. We're going to go into that spiritual Jerusalem. Still three. I'm looking for the city where it's true foundation. A home in the heavens not built by hands. Designer and builder is the Lord of God of the ages. So, we're looking for that city. It's in Hebrews chapter 12. Open up your Bible, Hebrews chapter 12. By the way, you have to write it down. You have to talk about it at home here. You meditate upon it at home. Hebrews chapter 12. What verse is Heavenly Jerusalem? Everyone. The one who first sees it and shouts it out will receive blessing from God. I pronounce that blessing upon that person who actively participates. What verse? 12:22. Receive your blessing from God. Prosperity preacher. Okay. Now, so this is real prosperity. You're active spiritually. God will bless you. Don't look at blessing as just material things. Look it up as your relationship with Him. But of course, God also would love to bless you materially too. Now, that city in Hebrews chapter 12 is that same city in Revelation 3:12. It's that same city in Revelation 21. Open up your Bibles again, and this time I'm going to ask you to read. Brother Jerry, from, I don't care for sister. Oh yeah, she should be adopted by someone else. Okay, oh, you chose Sister Erica. Revelation 21. Okay, please read verse 1.
Revelation 21.
Everyone look it up.
And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, and New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, preparing as a bride adorned for His husband.
Okay, thank you, sister. Next, what verse will the city in New Jerusalem will be mentioned? Sister Yana? Revelation 21 verse? Not two, lower verses. 8 or 9. Please read. Where's the microphone? Give it to her. I'm a reporter.
And they carried me away the spirit of great and high mountain, and showed me the
great city,
the holy Jerusalem, ascending out of heaven from God.
No. We're looking for that city. You look to be part of that city. That's the only way. Because when Babylon falls, that's the tribulation period. This whole world will be burned up. That's the tale of two cities. I'm going to give a typology of that city to a woman. So, tale of two cities, two women. What is that two women? The woman in Revelation 12. That's the woman. And there's an old teaching. Oh well, there's a basic Protestant teaching that the woman in Revelation 12 represents Israel. Woman. But we believe in parallelisms. Brother Frank, if you look at his red book, open your letter 17. He also talks about the church. So, aside from the woman Israel, it's also about the church. So, there's Israel, and there's spiritual Israel, which is the church. Out of him will come forth the man-child. I'd like to bring into remembrance those who were here last Sunday night. I opened up the scripture in Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. Everyone, open up. I'm just gonna bring back some recollection from that verse. That verse are benefits of the 70 weeks. Most teachers of the 70 weeks would say that is for the Jew, for Israel. But there is a hidden mystery for the church, for the bride that would become the bride of Christ. Now, I'm going to call out certain people. Open up your Bible. Give me one benefit, Brother Samuel. Benefit or promise in, you don't have to read the whole verse. You just choose one benefit given in that verse. Everyone, make ready your benefit.
To finish the transgression.
That's one. To finish the transgression. Brother Jerry chose Allah.
To make reconciliation.
To make reconciliation for?
Iniquity.
Do you have iniquity?
Yes.
Everyone admits you have iniquity. A unless you admit you're a sinner, you don't feel any need for Christ. But if you fail, admit you're a sinner, then you could come to Christ. Wash my sins away. Of course, the biblical way, the judge counseling way from his ministers. Then, from reconciliation from iniquity, finishing the transgression, what's the third one? Sister
Mika.
I want the other Mika.
Next.
Daniel 9:24. 70 weeks are
there. You don't have to read the whole verse. You're
to bring an everlasting prosperity.
Everlasting righteousness.
We jump to the last one. Okay. To make an end of sins.
Okay.
To bring in everlasting righteousness. Last one. There's one last one. One last one. Last two more. Yeah, last two more. Last two more, last one more. Two more, okay. Vision and prophecy.
And to
what's the last one, Brother Benan?
To anoint.
To anoint the Most Holy. That is your blessing. When prophecy for you is sealed up, your soul, your spirit, your body are sealed up for the day of redemption. You have the seal of the Holy Ghost. Sealing up the vision and prophecy in your heart.
Amen.
17. So in any age, present truth, the word of God seals up your salvation until the day of redemption of your body. Sealing up the vision and prophecy, you would be included in that blessing.
Amen.
If you have prophecy in your hearts. Blessed is he that keepeth the words of this prophecy. That means to say, in your heart, to be sealed up with God, you have to be sealed up in his word. And his word contains prophecy, a promise. A promise that you one day will be taken up.
Amen.
How many among us wants to be taken up? Amen. Raise your hands. Say amen.
Amen.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. I want to be taken up, Lord. That should be your heart. You know, many luxurious things has been seen in this world. Even if you're not that that much rich, you could receive those luxuries. Those are idols that will take your attention away from grieving, from praying. Supplication for God, for God's word in your life, in your family. There is no contrition anymore. We sing as though it's just a show. We don't praise God anymore. Any manner you do praise God is just from your lips. It should be from the heart that seals you in prophecy. When you say prophecy, the message of the earth, what message of the earth do you have? Seal yourself up with that. Then, the anointing the Most Holy. It's not just anointing the temple. It's not just anointing Jesus Christ. It's anointing the New Jerusalem. You will receive anointing from God and you become the New Jerusalem, the new city. Now, the two women in Revelation 12, it's a type from Israel and the church, but there's a counterpart woman in Babylon. And what do you call that woman? Everyone, we're still going to call out some people. Revelation chapter 17. Mr. Micah, Alpha, Yana, Rap. Okay. kay Rap Rap Patrick. Then to get it without any coaching. Open up Revelation 17. What do you call that woman? There's a woman in Revelation 12. What do you call that woman? Call out others who can answer also. Sister Marisa, Sister Baby,
Christopher.
I'm not asking for the verse. Brother Samuel. What do you call that woman?
Harlot.
Another word.
Mother of all the harlot.
What war? What kind of war? They gave a description. The Great War. Don't you realize when you fall into worldliness, you also fall into immorality. Literally. Because you repeat, even your young people, your young children, you send them to schools, you don't have any training for the Lord, they fall into immorality, boredom. What happens to children that are growing up? You don't train them to no preparation of Abraham or LCM. What happens to them when they grow up? Biologically, they look for partners. And what kind of partner do they find? Worldly. And they fall to boredom. Majority fall to boredom. Marriage today is no longer much sanctified. And when your children earn money, you don't have any control for them.
Correct.
So parents, cherish the time if you still have any control for your children. While you have time, cherish the time and bring them in the ways of the Lord. One day you're going to lose your control over them. This world is a world of whoredoms.
Whoredoms.
Look at the advertisements. Look at the conversations, the jokes. Look at all the blockbuster movies. Of course, they're children movies. The children movies doesn't seem like directly immoral, but they tease you, they give you some hint that goes to that. Even Disney movies. Action hero movies, superhero movies. They lead to that. Then goes to the mature movies. Now let's say James Bond movies, it's exciting, it's action, it's suspense, but eventually they sublimize your mind. They condition your mind subconsciously in the small things that they put out there. They're not directly pornographic. They just give a little of this, little of that. Even in advertisements. Then you fall into boredom. Now what is boredom? I'm not just going to talk about physical boredom. I'm going to talk about spiritual boredom. You may be pure in your body, but spiritually, you are a whore because you don't know Jesus Christ. Everyone on earth who rejects Jesus Christ becomes spiritually a whore. Foolish that virgin that lost her virginity. Do you want to read that virginity? It's your hardness of heart towards His Word. Let's open it up. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2 and 3. So, please read for us. How many minutes will I take? Sister Irish? 20 minutes.
11:23.
Okay, everyone read alongside with Sister Irish. Four. Read alongside Sister Irish.
Over you with jealousy.
Everyone participate.
For I have exposed you to one husband.
Everyone, read it aloud.
Present you as a chaste virgin to Christ.
But I fear that losing
you.
Beguiled
him. So
my mind will be corrupted. That is in Christ. So, in your mind, if you're corrupted, you could lose your virginity to Christ. How did you lose your virginity? That you could no longer marry him. You could no longer be chosen from him. Because you rejected his word. You followed the guile of the serpent. The guile of the serpent is not a literal serpent animal being in front of you. Those are the things in the world. Those are the Nicolaitanism and lukewarmness brought about by the world and even the religious world. Babylon. Now, the Great War had many children, and of course, the old teaching is Catholic Church had her children, the Protestant churches. But today, her children is all that have fallen out, backslid from his word. We have to cry out to God in repentance. Let's open up to Thyatira Church Age. Open up your Bibles in Thyatira Church Age. Brother Allen, look for the verse about Jezebel, who teaches immorality to eat foods offered to idols. Therefore, I will cast her and her children. Verse? Chapter 2, verse 5? 24. Brother Allen, please read for us. Everyone?
24.
Look it up.
But unto you, I say, and unto the rest of the era, as many as have not this doctrine, and which have not known the depths of Satan, as they speak, I will put upon you none other burden.
I don't think that's Revelation, that's Thyatiran Church Age.
Verse
20. I will cast her, everyone, out somewhere, somewhere else, anyone else. What verse? I will cast her and her children with death. Chapter 2, verse 22. Sister Allah. So it's not?
22.
Okay, please read.
Revelation 2:22. Behold, I will cast her into a grave, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds.
Who commits adultery with her? In Revelation 17, it's the kings of the earth. Are you accepted? How can you commit adultery with her? You compromise your birthright, like Adam and Eve. You compromise in favor of what? You sold, you traded souls. So, you'll be cast into a tribulation. You are the children of the harlot. If you lost your virginity, that means to say your heart is hardened from receiving Christ in His Word. Everyone can say, I've received Christ, but they reject the Word. If you claim you're a follower of Christ, you would love His Word. You would be excited to read His love letter.
Amen.
Oh, I don't have any time for that. I'm busy. I have some other things. Then, your husband is no longer Christ. It's the old man. Revelation, Romans chapter 7, verse 1. It's your old man, and it's the devil. It's the old nature. It's the serpent. Let's read Romans 7, 1 and 2. Brother Jim, Romans 7, read it aloud.
7:1.
If he reads slow, that means to say he has not been.
Verse 1, know ye not, brethren, for I speak to that know the law, how that the law hath done ever amen as long as he liveth.
2.
Verse 2, for the woman which hath a husband is bound by the law. To a husband so long as he lives. But if the husband be dead, she is lost from the husband.
The old husband is sin. The old husband is your old nature. The old husband is the devil. The old soul is your blindness in this world. Exchange it. I'm trading my sorrow. Exchange it. With what? With a new husband. If your old husband has died, your old nature has died, you had a new husband, that's Jesus Christ, the new man in you. So this talks about marriage. Your salvation involves marriage. That's why there's a woman here, Israel, and she would become a purified wife. Let's open up Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25, 26, 27. So continuously read, Patrick. Rabrab, Samuel, Mika.
Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Ephesians
5:25. 26.
That he might sanctify Vincent with the washing of the water
by the word. Next.
That he might present it to himself a
glorious church, not having spot
or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy without blemish.
What verse is that?
27.
Okay. Now, unless you're married to Jesus Christ, you have no hope in you. You know, every people born on earth, after they work, after they earn money, after they have their fill of enjoyment, what do they look for? Marriage. If not marriage, living in fornication. They look for a partner, then sire children. Like animal instincts. But whatever it is, their purpose in life is biological, to look for a partner. To raise it. Decent ones, they look to raise a family. Those indecent ones, they sire different children all around, like animals. Of course, if you repent, you should settle down. But whatever it is, your purpose in life is to look for a spouse. That is your unconscious instinct written within your genes. And you don't know, spiritually, there's a hunger there. There's a hunger within your soul to look for meaning in life. Those who have experienced married life, they find, oh, is this everything there is to it? Unless you're rich or excited or some adventure. No, it's so boring. Sometimes they look for other spouses, some other partners. They look for excitement because they don't know the real meaning of life. The mystery of marriage. God instituted marriage to point you to Jesus Christ. And if you don't recognize, acknowledge that reason for existence, I'm not just talking about marriage, I'm talking about your very being. You live because of Him. You do not exist because of Him. God would not even create a speck of dust in the universe without Him. And you owe your existence to Him. You owe your redemption to Him. And because God wants you to meet Him and become one with Him, His beloved Son. And if you lose that purpose in life, you lose your essence of being, and you just go degrade back down as like an animal instinct in this world. You don't have any meaning in life. Oh, let's go to malls. Let's go to some Let's give some, the children some playground for them to be happy. But, or some competition at schools, or sometimes they have family fun day at school or whatever. To give people some meaning in life. But they're just blinding themselves. It's just to pass the time away until you grow older. And for what? The very purpose of life is from the author of life. He wants to give you eternal life, to live eternally in peace with Him. But you're blinded by Babylon. You've lost your vision. You lost sight of who you're supposed to be. So, how many minutes did I take up? 20? 30 already. Did I get 40 already? Okay. This tale of two cities, it involves you and me. These two cities also represents these two kinds of women. The harlot woman, the great whore, and the woman in Ephesians 5 that will be a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, a virgin. That's what I have you understand. The wise virgin is came off from the foolish virgin because she lost her foolishness. But if you don't lose your foolishness, you will lose your virginity. Do not stay ignorant, even parents, because your children will lose their virginity. Oh, I don't want to talk about it. I avoid the training. I just make my own, cook my own way. You submit to look to God. You're not submitting to men. You're submitting to God's revelation, God's way. A better way. For yourselves, for your family. Shall we say amen?
Amen.
Let's give God a big hand.